Join Tricia Carr and I for the 2019 Mediumship Intensive starting this September 9th. Students of the Intensive will learn how to open their intuitive perception and fearlessly navigate the beautiful world of spirit, communicate with departed loved ones, beings of light, angels, masters, and more. Mediumship is absolutely natural and it's for everyone. Check the link in the description of this video to learn more.
Oh, I remember you have an experience where you actually kind of weren't, you didn't really believe or align with angels, and you had an experience of meeting Archangel Gabriel. Would you like to share that? Yeah. And because I remember when you saw him, you kind of saw a man's face or something, right? A humanoid face.
I saw a dude, for real. I at the time, it was funny because I was a professional intuitive reader. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was definitely connected spiritually, lots of evidences in my life, but angels was just kind of that holdout that I had. I was like, that's just high vibration energy. That's just source energy. It's our need for some sort of comfort that makes us need to have angels. And so that was my mindset. My friend at the time invited me to a class on angels, and I kind of just wanted to hang out with her, go into the city. So I went, and it was basically a class that taught us to connect with our guardian angel. Mm-hmm. And I listened, and I remember the teacher very clearly to this day. This was years ago. Just her presence was something about this lady was so different. She was kind of a bigger stature and she had this booming voice, but her energy was incredibly powerful. And looking back at it, I can see now that she was in the energy of an archangel. But anyway, she led us through a group meditation. There were probably about 30 of us there at the time. And I've been in a lot of meditations in my day, and I've done a lot of spiritual techniques and work, and I have never felt the kind of energy that was presenting itself to me in that circle. And at some point my head was bowed, but again, I was a little dubious. So I was kind of checking people out. They were really into it. And I was like, okay, whatever. But I saw out of the corner of my eye, and here my eyes were open. I saw kind of a light in the up towards the ceiling of the room in one corner. It was a light, and I looked at it and the light started to expand. And this was my cue, and I won't go too deeply into this. This is just a technique. This was my cue to sort of expand my perception and graft my third eye onto what I was looking at with my naked eye. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I was looking at the light, and I was also perceiving with my mind's eye, and this light expanded and became a spiral, and I was watching it. It got bigger and bigger. I started to feel this energy in my body that became somewhat overwhelming. I was like, what's going on? Mm-hmm. And out of this spiral, long story short, popped a man. He kind of was in the spiral and then became the silhouette of a man. And the spiral man dropped himself right in front of me as I was sitting in that circle. And he was on one knee with his fist under his chin like this, looking up at me, kind of like a jaunty grin, you know, just kind of sense of humor, sparkle in his eye. But I was so shocked. That was the most evidential that... to date and since then, the most evidential thing that had ever happened to me. And he was right in front of me. He was dressed in kind of what looked like Robin Hood clothes. I don't know, period type clothes, but super simple. And I felt such an electric shock in my body. I was already overwhelmed, but such a shock that I began to, what I would say is convulse a little bit in my chair because it was just too much. And long story short, I ended up having a conversation with this being telepathically, which is where a lot of this kind of communication happens. And I asked him who he was, and he told me his name was Gabriel. And that's when I was like, oh, okay, oh, angels, they're real. And he also dosed me so powerfully with his energy that it was nothing, like, again, nothing I'd ever felt previous to, and I have felt it since, but so powerful and different. This is that frequency, that dial we're talking about. Yeah. These different beings have different signatures. But he had to dose me like that in order for me to like, wake up, lady, this is available to you. Are you ready to work with it? And sure enough, since then I have.
And how interesting is it that because you were in that kind of liminal space of, do I believe, don't I believe, angels, I don't know. And he showed up as a man, which of course he's never, the principle of angelic energy of is that they haven't incarnated. That's kind of the general principle. Right. But he used the form because that was what where you were. Like that's what was going to be very evidential for you. And it was kind of like that bridge for you. It's just really pretty cool.
Yeah. And it made, it possibly made it more, it was easier, I guess, for me to have that interaction with him looking like a human being, looking like a human man. But there was just so much energy to just that wry sense of humor, this knowingness that he brought with it, that it was just powerful. that is all part of mediumship. That is just part of expanded perception.
Yes.
And that's what makes it so interesting. And again, that's what makes it so magical.
I have a story about the first time when I was first starting to consider that angels were real, because even in my evangelical Christian kind of background, yeah, they were real, but in that kind of spirituality, you don't connect with them. You're not allowed to even. They're just in the Bible and they're just a part of it. And you're like, yeah, I guess they live up there with God in some place where we can't see them and you experience them. You know, you don't deal with them. But then I, you know, long since when I opened up metaphysically, I had long since left the church, but I'd never really worked with angels or considered them. And so I was like in that time where I had just opened up metaphysically, but I had a meditation practice, but I was exploring, just like consuming so much. And I got my first little book on angels because I was like, why not? Let's see what this business is about. And I think it was actually Doreen Virtue's, one of her books on angels. And so in the book, I'm like at the very beginning and the author, in case, I'm pretty sure it was Doreen, but the author says that you can ask for your guardian angel's name. And I was like, cool. And I like put the book down and I took a breath and I said, what's my guardian angel's name? And I heard Ariel in my mind's ear, you know? And I was like, Ariel? Like the Little Mermaid? That doesn't sound very angelic. Like that's my, that was what I understood. That's how little I knew about angels. And I like, because the reason that's kind of funny is because those of you who do know about angels, connect with them in the kind of Hebrew mysticism or Hebrew and Christian and English speaking languages. And that kind of construct, EL means of God. It's, you know, from Hebrew. And so it's a typical EL ending is typical for angels' names, you know, for us. But I didn't even know that. I didn't really realize that. And so I'm like, whatever. And I'm like Googling and I'm like, Angel Ariel. Well, the first thing that shows up is actually the Little Mermaid. And then a couple of things down, it's Archangel Ariel. And I'm like, what? That's crazy. And I click on it. And it was probably actually Doreen Virtue's website too, because it's like the highest in the Google search. And it says Archangel Ariel oversees nature and animals. And especially like telepathic communication with them. And I had already started practicing my animal communication abilities. And I just about had to change my pants because I did all the things that you do in your pants when you're stunned. And then, of course, I go forward a little bit. And, of course, Archangel Ariel is in the book that I was reading. And I read all about that angel. But what was interesting was that that author also said that the archangels are not your guardian angels. And so I was like, oh, I must have misunderstood because I asked for my guardian angel, but I heard an archangel. And I was like so confused. And so then I said, well, I must have misunderstood. So who's my guardian angel? And I actually got another name that was Aliel, A-L-I-E-L, a masculine presence. And so it's basically like because I chose to shift my beliefs a little bit there, mm-hmm. you know, an intermediary angel who's probably on my team or a different expression of Ariel came through, which by the way, forget about that. Guardian angels can't be your archangels, whatever. All of that. There's no hierarchy. So respectfully, I disagree with that author that it doesn't really matter. But that was I didn't know from Archangel Ariel from anything. And that I got that directly and it just made so much sense that it pretty much made me convulse the way that
I know. I can't imagine another angel that would be a better fit for you. In fact, if I were to imagine what Archangel Ariel looks like, I would say she would look like, I see her as feminine. I would say you look like a physical representation. And you see that with angel people, not to sidetrack this with all about angels, but, angel people tend to take on the energetic representation. They tend to be energetic representations, but also physical representations of the principles of the archangels and the angels that they are kind of in alignment with. And so it would make sense to me that you are the lioness. You come from the lioness of God, and that's who Ariel is. But one thing I want to say is not just angels. There are, again, ascended masters and also historic figures that you can connect with. One of the historic figures that I've always just really admired is Edgar Cayce. Yes. I speak about him a little bit here and there, but I just found him to be an intuitive person, a medium and a channel who had the utmost integrity. And he did all of his readings for in service to others. I don't think he ever charged for any of his readings. In fact, he probably passed earlier than he needed to because he worked himself in this type of service, but I just always really liked him. And one of the reasons I really liked him was because he had a similar background as I had. Mm-hmm. In that he was a fundamentalist Christian. He had memorized the Bible. He really believed in the Bible. But then these abilities that he had started to really expand. And what started off as kind of medical intuition reading started to include things on reincarnation and past lives and medical, just more and more things, Atlantis and things that kind of scandalized him when he saw what he had channeled after he woke up. He was called the Sleeping Prophet. Anyway, though, because of his beginning and because of his integrity, I just always really liked him. And probably about 10 years ago, Edgar Cayce started showing up in my experience. Now, one of the easiest ways for departed loved ones and past people, past humans, to show up in our experiences is through dreams. This is when our walls are down, we're sleeping, we're not kind of caught up in our narratives, we're not living defensively and reactively in this world, we're just sleeping, we're in the subconscious. And so it's really easy for them to kind of drop in and have an encounter with you. This is usually the first way that somebody who's passed away that you loved will come back and just get a message to you. But Cayce started showing up in some of my dreams, and it was real similar to a normal visitation dream. I would be in the course of a mundane dream when I would turn a corner, and there he would be kind of sitting on a bench, and I'd be like, oh, that's Edgar Cayce. And I'd go and sit next to the bench, and I'd have these conversations with him. And I spent some time in dream state with Cayce, but then I started meditating in my wakeful time, which is meditation is a state akin to sleep, but is not sleep. And we'd start having encounters there, and I would continue to receive messages from him and really instruction from him. And I took note at that time of what his frequency was like. Again, there's the frequency of mediumship. Within the frequency of mediumship are all the personalities that we can actually pick up in this way. And you can whittle that down all the way to a personality. So Cayce felt a certain way, and I would recognize, just as I'm walking through the Safeway, walking through the Starbucks, when I was feeling his presence, and I would stop and I'd be able to have a communication or an interaction. But you can literally communicate, contact, reach out to just about anybody. It's been my experience that someone who has passed, even if it's been a long, long time, and even if they have gone on to reincarnate once or twice, you can still contact their oversoul. You can still contact their higher mind connected to the individual that they were when they were alive, and also their past and future lives as well. It gets all crazy.
Join Tricia Carr and I for the 2019 Mediumship Intensive starting this September 9th. Students of the Intensive will learn how to open their intuitive perception and fearlessly navigate the beautiful world of spirit, communicate with departed loved ones, beings of light, angels, masters, and more. Mediumship is absolutely natural, and it's for everyone. Check the link in the description of this video to learn more.